My name is Brady Plunger. I'm one of the Associate Curators of Education at the University of Iowa Stanley Museum of Art. And it is my privilege to welcome you all to tonight's talk, the first in a series celebrating this year's Grant Wood Fellows. Before we begin, I'd like to thank our partners, the Grant Wood Art Colony, the Provost's Office, the Division of Performing Arts, and the Theater Department. I would also be remiss if I didn't thank all of our friends of the museum, and especially Yvonne McCabe, sponsor of the Stanley's virtual programming this year. It is my honor to introduce Margarita Blush, Grant Wood Fellow and Visiting Assistant Professor in Directing. Blush, a Bulgarian-American theater artist, works as a director, performer, and teacher in the field of devised theater. Her work blends live acting, puppetry, movement, conceptual design, and original live music to produce imaginative and thought-provoking theater experiences for the audience. She is the artistic director of Margarita Blush Productions, an ensemble-based company that creates and performs original work. Blush's latest production, Unfolding 2015, has been performed at festivals and venues in the US, Bulgaria, and Turkey. And in the spring of 2019, the show was performed at the Tank in New York City to great critical and audience acclaim. In summer 2019, as a recipient of the Asian Cultural Council Individual Fellowship, Blush traveled to Japan for 8 weeks to study traditional Japanese theater forms. Please join me from your own homes, wherever you are, in a rousing round of applause for our esteemed guest, Margarita Blush. And I'm clapping and I hope that was-
I am hearing it. It's washing over me.
All right, I'm gonna mute myself and let you take it away.
Hello, everyone. It's a mystery to me who's all out there. Can I see anybody, or I guess I cannot? 27 people. Okay, hello, everyone. I can't see you, but we're in this together. Before we continue in actually this disembodied space in which we function nowadays, because it's exactly what it is, we don't have anything below the torso. I would like to invite you to actually, I'll guide you through a super quick, maybe 1 minute mindfulness meditation in order for us to arrive in the space and to try to be as embodied as we possibly can be. So I can't see you. I don't think anybody can see anybody else. So I invite you to either close your eyes or keep them open, whatever's comfortable for you. And first give it a stretch in any way, shape, or form that you feel your body wants to do right now. And just like you got up first thing in the morning, especially if you've had a long day and like an animal, like a cat waking from a nap. And after you've done that, arrive in your space. You're probably sitting in a chair, maybe you're not, but wherever you are, just feel the feet on the ground, the sit bones on the chair, your hands maybe on your thighs, maybe on the arms of the chair, your lower back pressing against the back of the chair, the spine lifted towards the ceiling or the sky. I cannot imagine that any one of you is outside right now, but you never know. And just think of your breath, and you can put one hand on your belly and one hand on your chest, on your heart. And feel these two forces that are the only thing you actually need right now is your heart, your breath. And just imagine arriving in your body in this moment of time, in this short moment of time in which we'll try to connect 1 hour. Maybe hear the room, the sounds in the room around you, maybe hear what's happening? Feel the air around you. Is it warm? Is it cold? The touch of your clothing. And take one really deep breath And before we open our eyes, let's try to imagine that when we open our eyes, we're going to see the world anew, as if for the first time. And we open our eyes and we try to see the world anew. So I am going to proceed. One of the most important things is that we all desperately try to connect over these virtual disembodied spaces. I would love the biggest thrill for me to get more questions to answer at the end. So please, if you think of anything, either send it in the chat, jot it down. So when the time comes and we say, you know, any questions, I can really engage with you and answering questions in order to make this as meaningful experience for all of us as possible. So that said, I will begin by sharing a PowerPoint with you and talking about my work. And the topic of tonight's conversation is my voice. And we'll get to this in just a second, and I will, of course, talk about more about that. So with that said, I am going to go ahead and share my screen with you. And look at that. That's me. So I call myself a devised visual theater artist. I talked a lot about where I come from, my training and all of that in my fall conversation. And this time I'm going to focus to go deeper into the work rather than just talking about myself. And now if we click, okay, this is how we advance. I say that I create theater through a vision-driven devising process. And this process is non-linear. It's not traditional process. I am not going to talk a lot about it now. If you have any questions at the end, I can explain more. Especially, I left this, this is from my last talk, but I left it here because this is really important to me. The poetically envisioned and meticulously crafted interplay of form and content has become the hallmark and driving force of my work. So in my work, I blend form and content in order to create a unity of expression. But once again, this is not the topic of tonight's conversation, but it is important enough for me and my work to mention. So the topic for tonight is my voice, creating original theater inspired by personal experiences and fueled by societal issues. And when I say this, I kept telling the directing students last semester, excuse me, of course, theater begins inside of us. Without a healthy dose of ego, you cannot be an artist, right? We are artists because there's something burning inside of you that you want to share with the world. And experiences that we have, we put into our art, into our productions, into our paintings, into our music. It is something that we have to experience first. At the same time, I keep saying theater and art is not therapy. You know, there's space for therapy, and there is, in order for a personal experience to become a piece of art, it needs to be transposed. It needs to mean something to more than me, right? It begins inside of me, but it needs to have like the ripple effect of a drop falling. Okay, if I'm the drop, there's waves that happen and touch people beyond me, touch the world in a way, because everything matters. We are very insignificant and very significant at the same time. So the themes that I am particularly interested in are the ones you see on one side of this beautiful slide. Themes relevant to the lives of women. I am a woman. I am a cisgender heterosexual woman. So this is my experience. This is where I begin my experience as a woman, but it is really important to me to explore themes that are important to the lives of contemporary women. justice and injustice. The other side of justice is really important to me. I've always fought for justice. I've never been afraid to speak up. I've always been a rebel. I have never accepted authoritarian power and power that is without reason. So I always rebel against any kinds of injustice. Equality, inequality, something that I think has become a very important topic for all of us. But of course, I have my personal experiences with that, and it's really important to me. The theme of greed is really important to me as well, because it is human greed that causes pretty much all terrible things in the world, and has always done that. And the theme of connections, connections between people, connections between us and the world, connections between us and the meaning of life, however you want to look at it, connections is something really important to me. So these are the primary themes that I am interested in my work. I will begin by talking about unfolding. This is the last production that I've created, and then I'll move forward to the production I'm currently creating, The Rule of the World. But unfolding exists. It has existed since 2015, and it has been performed all over the world. As you heard, here in the US, Bulgaria, Turkey, we were approached to go to Egypt. So maybe next year we'll be going to Egypt with the production, which I'm super excited about. It was going to be this year, but it wasn't possible. So Unfolding is a show that I say it was a woman's path, journey towards wisdom and self-discovery. And I created this show, the beginnings of this show was, I found myself in my early 40s, now I'm in my late 40s, but in my early 40s, I found myself in this space in time when I could look back at who I was as a child, as a young woman. I could see who I am now, and I could see where I'm going. I could see it, I could look at my mother and see things that she has experienced and she has said to me that maybe now I am going through and are making sense for the first time. I look at my daughter, who is now 21. She was in her mid-teens, obviously, 6 years ago, when she was blossoming to be, leaving her childhood and blossoming to be a woman. Women around me, mentors, I've had so many amazing women mentors. Women have always had such an important part in my life. My grandmothers, and all the women around me, like once again, that ripple, that the connection between the feminine, the women. And I said, I want to create a production that captures this, that captures that experience. Of course, once again, beginning with my own experience. And I wanted it to take a very mythological aspect and it almost be like a fairy tale, but the contemporary fairy tale. How can we tell a fairy tale today that has the elements of the magic of a fairy tale from the past, but is actually gives us something new, that what might be a 21st century fairy tale? This is the image you see here is the very beginning of the show where a moon is conjured, a very, you know, a symbol very deeply embedded with the feminine. And I will guide you through the show with few images and kind of making it a point of how my personal experience and the societal issues have interplayed in creating the work. The creation of life, we have the three fates or the three witches from folklore and mythology conjuring life. They actually, these little light, they're little beads of light that will become the child that is born in a moment. And here we have a moment of a womb. Actually, there are some shadow projections inside of it, and it's a beautiful imagery of, and very powerful imagery. When women see it, especially women who have had children, and it looks like a very poetic ultrasound, really, just the shadow imagery of a child in a womb. From here, we go into childhood, and here is everything is possible. In Aya is the main character, the puppet Aya, who's born out of the womb we just saw. In her childhood, everything is possible. And I look back at who I was as a child and how, you know, I wanted to capture this. Unless you've had a traumatic childhood, in a way, you don't know what your life as a woman will be or what injustices await you. You just are. Of course, comes the point when you encounter the first time of any kind of inequality or injustice, but this is the childhood scene of Aya when everything is possible. She climbs the tree without thinking, and then she jumps off the tree and she flies. She doesn't think that she can't. And she flies away with her bird until she lands on the tree again, falls asleep. And this is every moment of transformation in the show is captured in shadow imagery, because the shadows are where something out of this world happened. This is our dreams, this is the beyond, but she transforms into a young woman after her sleep, which is a very folk tale element. After her awakening, she actually stumbles on this young person and she falls in love. They fall in love. We have some, you know, really kind of funny, kind of romantic scenes between the two of them. And actually, one of the beautiful moments here in the show is she tries to fly again, but she cannot with him. She has to either fly away alone or she needs to stay down with him. It's too much for her to bear. So she makes the choice as a young woman. And once again, I got married when I was 22, and I was very young. I was very stupid. We both were. And you start giving up parts of yourself as a woman so often without thinking. You're like, of course, this is what I need to do. So you start giving up parts of yourself, which are not necessarily bad or traumatic, but you do. You start making sacrifices for other people in order to accommodate other people's needs. And parts of you disappear. And you, here is actually when this is one of the best scenes of the show. It's a very funny scene in which after a night together, they wake up to a crying. This performer in the corner is crying, a baby crying, and they're both like, what is going on here? And here we have the performer makes in front of the audience's eyes out of their blanket that they were covered with. She makes a baby and she hands it to them. So here a very funny scene ensues when she's like, no, you hold the baby. He's like, no, you hold the baby. No, you rock the baby. You know better. So anyway, there's another piece that now she needs to take care of. And here we go into the transformation of becoming a mother. And this is a personal homage to my mother, which this is the apron. We put on this little tiny apron on the puppet because my mother always said that when she was born, her fairies blessed her with wearing an apron her entire life. She wears an apron in the kitchen. I wear an apron in the kitchen, but my mother has spent at least a third of her life wearing the apron, cooking for the family, cleaning. This is the next transformation for our character when she has to don these things and take care of business. And all the childhood things, like in when she was a child, the flowers were, if you remember, the hat, or she played with the flowers. Suddenly they hand her a flower. She thinks, oh, beautiful, another flower. But they're like, no, it becomes a broom. And they're like, okay, you go. And this is, we kind of go into a Cinderella moment in which she needs to start taking care of cleaning the house and taking care of the baby. Once again, I'm not trying to say that, you know, this is what every woman does. At the same time, this domestic work traditionally has fallen more onto women. I actually just saw an article a couple of days ago how after the pandemic, for the first time after millennia, men are like, oh my gosh, there's so much domestic work. Once again, this is not everybody, but the majority of us have experienced this. So we go through this scene, which is, I call the domestic machine, in which it gets more and more intense. She has to clean, the baby's crying, she needs to rock the baby, she needs to clean, she needs to do the laundry, the baby's crying, she needs to clean, she needs to do the laundry, the baby's crying. And she reaches a point in which she actually hits the bird that this bird is, travels with her from the beginning of her life. This is the bird she flew with, the bird that has visited, is with her. You can say it's her sidekick. It's, to me, it's her soul or her creative spirit. She reaches a moment where she's so overwhelmed that she hits the bird. And the bird, the three performers, who are the three fates, take away the bird and say, okay, you can't, you know, if you're gonna hit it, they don't say it actually, but with movement, it is expressed that you can't have it anymore. And this moment in the show expresses that idea that women lose themselves at some point of their lives. Almost every woman has lost either a small part of herself or a huge part of herself. And we need, you know, some of us come back from the brink and some of us don't. But this is where, this is the moment where she kind of collapses and she goes into this very dark space. It's these nightmares once again represented with shadows in which she questions, like, I'm not good enough, I'm not strong enough, I'm not smart enough. All of these things that very often women tell themselves, I'm not enough, I'm an imposter, I'm not enough, I'm too much, or I'm either not enough or I'm too much. I'm too loud, I'm too big, I'm too emotional, I'm too this, I'm too that, or, oh, why aren't you stronger? Why aren't you this? So women vacillate between this constant pressure put on us to be, but not to be, or if we are, why are we? I know I've experienced a lot of that in my life, being, you know, a strong, big, you know, loud, emotional, all of the above woman. I've been told once by a colleague, couldn't you just be a little bit more like, you know, subdued? And then she goes on this journey to reclaim her bird. And this is the moment she needs to find herself. She needs to find what she lost. And she encounters the tree again, the tree from her childhood, which is now, we reveal the face of the old crone, the archetype of the crone, who actually gives her the power. She brings back to her, they have a moment on the tree and the crone pushes her off the tree and she flies again. And we say this is her earned flight, and the bird joins her again. And after the bird joins her at the end of the show, the bird gives her one of its feathers and she starts writing. And if you see on the set, there's, the whole set is covered in writing, because my whole idea was that she needs to record her wisdom. She needs to pass it on somehow. And actually this quote by Hélène Cixous from The Laugh of the Medusa was given to me after our performance in Turkey, when these women poets came to the stage after the show and said, oh my gosh, have you heard of this? And I had never heard of this essay. And I was like, but this is what the show is about. So a woman must write herself. And here I have to move this thing. Can I move it? Yes, I can. Okay. A woman must write herself, must write about women and bring women to writing, from which they have been driven away as violently as from their bodies. And this is what I wanted to do with the show. I wanted to remind women, we need to write ourselves. We need to give each other voice. I believe we, you know, after, since people have felt this, I think that we reach that amazing moment. From here, we go into The Rule of the World, which is my current show. We kind of venture into a completely different territory. Let's take a one deep breath and leave unfolding behind. And I hope that you will have questions that I can answer. So The Rule of the World was inspired once again by my personal experiences of injustice. A few years ago, I actually lost my job through very unjust and manipulated circumstances. And at the same time, the election of 2016 was happening. And I suddenly saw this world around me. My personal world was collapsing of like, how is this possible? And then I was looking at the world beyond me on, you know, national, international scale going, oh my gosh, how is this possible? How is this happening to people? How is lie surviving and lying is accepted over truth? Or I just couldn't fathom. And it, of course, it made me think of Kafka, because it was a very surreal Kafkaesque experience. In which at the end I had to stand in front of a board of directors and explain myself, and, you know, which they had made up their mind. No matter what I said, they had made up their mind about me. And, you know, I read the trial once again. I was like, oh, very Kafkaesque. Let's see what's happening here. You know, and I found this quote, depressing view, the lie made into the rule of the world. So I started thinking, I want to create a show based on this, but I don't want it to be, you know, somebody getting fired. I wanted to go beyond that, once again, bridging my personal experience, but transposing it for the theater. So I conceptualized with the designer this linear set that looks like a pickup sticks game, that it's constantly being transformed, as because I felt like my life is this like game of pickup sticks that I'm trying to pick up and hold, but they constantly fall and you need to start picking up the pieces all over again. The show doesn't exist. It's just the conceptual idea exists. I need to go into rehearsals with performers in order to bring it to life. But I'm going to play with few moments, which is the first one is the land of opportunity. I'm an immigrant, you know, the whole very, very fake notion that anything is possible in the United States. Yes, some of it is possible, but who is it really possible for? You know, does it matter which degree you got from which institution and how many contacts you have and who your parents know? I guarantee you it does. I became so idealistic, and I was like, oh, the work will speak for itself. If you don't have the contacts, honey, you can create, you know, anything you want. But so I realized that really the game is rigged. So here the main character, who will be a puppet again, will be going through this land of the opportunity, which will be an obstacle course, and she'll be told that anything's possible. She just needs to get from point A to the end of the obstacle course. But the rules will always change. Suddenly somebody will, the performers will, now you need to jump twice as far. Oh, this path is only open if you have received your degree from, and it's going to be a very surreal, very Kafkaesque experience, very humorous. And at the same time, we realize that there's no way that she can conquer this obstacle course because it's rigged, the game. You know, the rules change and they don't apply for everybody. The next segment of the show will be building a dream, in which you'll be like, okay, then I have a dream and I'm going to build my dream. And of course, here I'm tapping into not only each one of us has a personal dream, but of course, when we say I have a dream, of course, we imagine that's how this goes beyond me, that who has the right of building a dream. This is when she's almost finished with this house. It's like a house-like structure that she'll be building. these inspectors will come and tell her once again, they're the performers, oh, you are 2 centimeters over the line, and do you have the permit? And who told you you can, do you have the education? Did you know that the board has voted last? So it's going to be these very surreal Kafkaesque excuses, which she'll be told that she has no right to build a dream because she doesn't have the qualifications. Once again, it taps in my experience as a woman, as an immigrant, but also it's like, who has the right to build a dream if you think about it? And then the next scene, the trilogy continues. She'll be like, okay, this is not right. This is not just, I will go and fight. And she goes into a very Quixotian battle with the system, which will be represented with this windmill, which will rotate. And she gets absolutely demolished by the system. There's no way that she can win. And we find her, I want the whole set to collapse in this moment on top of her. And she comes out of the ruins with a choice of giving up or not giving up. And she's going to pick up a few little sticks from the ruins, and she's gonna build her wings. She's gonna climb to the top of this ladder and she's gonna take flight. And right when I was going in my experiences of injustice, I found these amazing paradoxical commandments. I think the author is Kenneth Keith, we'll see here in a moment. And they really inspired me because this is what I wanted. I was fighting for myself, but I was also fighting for the world. How do you know that the world is a messed up place and you still love the world? So we, in some way, shape or form, will transpose the words, but something like this while she's flying will possibly hear that people are illogical, unreasonable and self-centered, love them anyway. If you do good, people will accuse you of selfish ulterior motives. Do good anyway. If you're successful, you will win false friends and true enemies. Succeed anyway. The good you do today will be forgotten tomorrow. Do good anyway. Honesty and frankness make you vulnerable. Be honest and frank anyway. The biggest men and women with the biggest ideas can be shot down by the smallest men and women with the smallest minds. Think big anyway. People favor underdogs, but follow only top dogs. Fight for a few underdogs anyway. What you spend years building may be destroyed overnight. Build anyway. People really need help, but may attack you if you do help them. Help people anyway. Give the world the best you have, and you will get kicked in the teeth. Give the world the best you have anyway. So Kent Keith wrote these. And this is just a little bit more information about me, about, you know, my website, and please stay in touch. After the last talk, few people reached out to me via email and it has meant so much to me and I've made the connections with them and it was just amazing to get the feedback and to begin conversations. So with that said, I am done. And I hope that we can engage in questions about the work. Anything's fair game about me, about my life.
All right, everyone. Well, thank you, Margarita, for that wonderful talk. I think we're all applauding in our you know, homes and offices, wherever we are.
Once again, I'm imagining it.
It's like waves, right? Waves kind of washing over.
Yes, like a Freddie Mercury, like the whole stadium is.
That's what we want. That's it. So I have two questions that have popped up in the chat. So we'll start with attendees because I do have a question for you, but I'll hold
please
on to that. So from Eric Stone, can you reference the choice of the use of light white color for the costumes and the scenic elements for the overall palette in Unfolding? That's a question related to Unfolding.
The whole idea for, and this is where this idea of form and content that is so important to my work came into play. because I wanted the show to be about wisdom, the show was about, but not just wisdom, women's wisdom. I started thinking, what captures the idea of wisdom? You know, and first thing that popped into my brain was books. And I was like, no, it sounds too male. it's too intellectual, too like, oh, in the books. Women's wisdom, women's intuition is different. It kind of hides in the folds and is deeper and it's in the oral tradition. So then I started going, okay, what's older than books? What's older way of transmitting knowledge? Because it also was really important to me that women need to transmit their knowledge. And I, with the designer and I, conceptualized the idea of the scroll. So the idea was that everything is paper. Everything is made out of paper. And everything is one giant scroll in which everything, there's writing all over it. It is nonsensical writing. It's just kind of like, you know, just symbols. But this is how the whole thing began. And there's like a brown writing, the writing is brown. And this is where we, this is what we wanted to do in order to capture that idea of a scroll and paper.
Fantastic. I know I'll have a question about design for you later. Well, actually, maybe I'll ask it now since we're talking about unfolding. I was curious specifically with the puppets. Where do your design, your sort of visual inspirations come from?
Oh, that's a really good question. For every show, I do different kind of research. I do research a lot of art installations because I am very visual, but I also do a lot of literary research. For Unfolding, for example, I read fairy tales, I read Jungian theory, I read people's dissertations on the topic of the feminine in fairy tales and forgotten female writers of fairy tales. But I also did a lot of research into the world of folded paper. There's an artist called Eric Joycel, and he creates this origami. All of his work is origami. So it's one piece of paper, but then he wets it and he softens it. And it just looks, and I was like, this is what I want in my show. So it's the idea of origami, that there's something very meaningful hidden in the folds, but I didn't want the harsh edges that origami has. So this is where the visual research for Unfolding came from.
I love that term, visual research.
Oh, I do a lot of that, yes. I have folders of visual research.
Can you say any more about that quickly? Just because I think that's such an important term, and it's not a way that people think of research all the time.
Oh, yes. And for this is what happened for Unfolding, and you can see like the palette and the rule of the world is completely different. Once again, I started doing my literary research, which I read Kafka, I read most of his books, I researched what is Kafkaesque, I read essays, and then I stumbled through this research that actually Kafka did original drawings. And I almost pulled it up and then I didn't. I should have. Maybe I can try to find it, but I was very inspired by Kafka's, I'm going to try to find it really quick, Kafka's original drawings, which he did in his diaries. And the visual research for the show is very inspired by that. Hold on, I had it and I lost it. There it is. I think I'm very, very close. So the visual, as I said, I'm very inspired by visual art. So I would literally just put words, combinations of words, linear art installations. And I would stumble upon images. Then I select the images I want and I show them to my designers. To be like, this is what I want. This is what I want the show to look like. This is the direction I go. And actually I'm currently doing this with one of Eric's students, the designer for the grand wood production that we're doing, we did a lot of that, like imagining where, what it looks like visually. And once my slow computer loads that image, I will show it to you. Oh, I think it's there.
Hold on. Wonderful.
Yes, I will. Sorry about that. I should have trusted my instinct and pulled it up. This is unfolding wisdom for me. So these are Kafka's drawings. You know, the ladders, yes, they're amazing. They're just stunning. And so the ladders, the different palette, the, you know, the more darker black, very, very linear, and these like stick figures. So everything will be like this stick figures. The puppet will be more elongated, and thus the linear set came from stumbling on that.
Those drawings are incredible. I'm bowled over.
They are incredible. If you just Google Kafka's original drawings, they're incredible.
It's like he's prefiguring Russian suprematism, and I love it. I'm here for it.
Yes.
So we have a question in the Q&A box from Genevieve. Do you do most of the designing for your work, for example, the puppets, or do you lead the storytelling and hand the design to a team? And I think you started to touch on this, so that's why I wanted to move to this question.
So the work with a designer is extremely important to me. And this is very often I need to make that disclaimer, because as a puppet theater artist, especially here in the United States, people always assume that you do your own. Most American puppet theater artists make their own puppets, you know, design them, make them, perform, write for them. I believe, I come from the European school of puppetry, where we don't do that. We either train as a performer, we train as a director, we train as a designer for the puppet theater. Of course, there are some people that can do all of the above, but I choose to work with people who design is their art. And I get to hold the vision. I'm the director, creator. I assemble a team. The puppet for unfolding is so beautiful and exquisite. I could never in a million years, the designer who made it is actually, he's a visual artist and a sculptor. And puppets are moving sculptures. So I choose to work with people who can do so much more than I can. And then I focus, but I am very hands-on hands-on director. I don't say, oh, just do it. I'm like, they come back to me. It does this work? And I'm like, yes, it does. No, it doesn't. I am very hands-on. I participate in the choosing of the materials, of the aesthetics, of everything. So it's my vision that drives it, but yet the designer brings it to life. So I hire designers to collaborate. I invite them. I collaborate with people to work with me. It's a labor of love. Of course I pay people, but the way I work is that if you wouldn't do this project with me, even if I couldn't pay you, then don't do it. I mean, of course I pay. I don't work for like work for hire, work for money. There needs to be true artistic inspiration and passion. So no, I don't make my puppets. I don't make my costumes. They're designers who are better than me at that.
I never realized this difference. I'm not super familiar with the arts of puppetry, so I had no idea that there were these two different schools. But that's so interesting.
Well, in Europe, it's very different. Yeah.
So we do have another question in the chat from Eric Stone. In Unfolding during the transformation, how did you create the light silhouette of the bird? Was it separate from the moon image? How did the bird image move?
A little secret, revealing of secrets. This is actually in the realm of white shadows, or ombre blanc, as it is said in French. It is pretty much so if a shadow is the reflection of my hand, a large, if I cut out my hand out of a piece of paper and then I shone the light through that cutout, you will see a white shadow, which is not a shadow, it's the negative space. So this is how the bird is created. It's actually just on a flashlight. And at the end of the show, this is a beautiful moment when Aya dies. She dies and actually they fold her in her scroll. She's folded back. The bird flies out of the scroll and flies all over the theater because it can go anywhere. It's just a tiny little flashlight and it goes over people's heads and it kind of disappears into the top of the theater. So yeah, it's a very simple, low tech and very effective way of creating white shadows. So yeah, it is a separate image from the moon. Yes.
That's fantastic. And now I'm just picturing all that. You really gave us a wonderful image there. And one more question from Eric. Do you know the work of the South African artist William Kentridge and his staging of The Nose at the Met?
I do not. I saw that a moment ago. I do not. I'll write it down and I'll definitely look it up. I'm very intrigued.
And I will say at this point, I mean, we've hit the questions in the Q&A and in the chat, but if folks would like to raise their hands at all, and I'm happy to unmute you if you wanna speak a little bit. We're
Please speak.
We would love to hear from you. So raise those hands and we'll get you. And I just have to say, Margarita, those visuals are just absolutely stunning. I mean, I couldn't get over the thinking about the folds, and that's what I was so drawn to in those photos of unfolding, and then seeing, hearing you talk about the folding and the act of folding. It's really incredible. So I do see a couple folks with their hands raised. So I'm gonna go ahead and call on unmute, I should say, not call on, unmute Genevieve first.
Hi, Margarita.
Hi, Genevieve.
I was just kind of curious, since it is divisive work, do you have any sort of a script that you're working with, since a lot of it is movement-based and not dialogue, not as much dialogue. So is there sort of like a script that's laid out, or is it all just kind of like muscle memory, sort of everybody just working on the show so much and knowing it so well?
That's a really great question. And, you know, very important to say it's devised work. But yeah, very important question. I used to, in the past, my previous shows that were based on folk tales, The Crane Wife and River Story, I actually wrote the script. I wrote the script and then we put it on its feet. For Unfolding, I wanted a completely different process. First of all, I wanted to see how much I can say just through visuals. So there's literally like 20 lines in the whole show that are not even spoken on stage, they're recorded because it was part of the aesthetic. Only things that absolutely could not be said through the visuals were said with words. And so there were the blessings in the very beginning when the three fates, or the three fairies from fairy tales, when they give the blessings to the girl. I really wanted wonky blessings, and some of them are like, they tell her she'll have big feet. She will run fastest in open fields. She will be... she will have insatiable curiosity. So those are the blessings are written. And the way we did it, though, this is the part of the process, is I asked the performers, we were all in the room, and I said, okay, come up with five things about physical appearance, what she'll have as a physical appearance. Then write five things as qualities of her character, five things of relationship advice. And then from all of these things that people wrote, four of us times five, you can imagine how many lines, we read them to each other and we chose the ones we liked the most. So it was not me writing it, it was the whole ensemble. And then we chose them, we shaped them if we needed to. So I write through the body. We write in the rehearsal room. And then the other things that were written for the show were the nightmare visions when she, you know, I'm not good enough. I'm not strong enough. I'm too much. I want too much. Once again, I ask the performers to write down, what are your deepest insecurities as a woman? What is the biggest things that is weighing on you? That is the depth in your nightmare. And they wrote them and we picked once again, the best ones. For the rule of the world, I imagine there will be a lot more text in that show. Once again, performers will be improvising based on my prompts. They will be creating material. And out of their verbal improvisations, we're going to record them and then shape them into a script. If I am blessed with for the first time, I'm flirting with the idea of inviting a playwright in the room, but it's not the playwright who's going to sit in somewhere remotely and write for us. I want the person to be in the room. And when the performers are improvising, to capture and shape the text. So this is how text is generated in this kind of work. It is born literally through the body, through the rehearsal process, through the devising work. So yes, we have, ultimately you have a scenario, or for the rule of the world, it will be more of a script, but it is not somebody wrote it somewhere and we put it on stage. It is part of the work.
We have a really wonderful follow-up question to this from Hallie. What is the most emotionally draining element of making your work, and how do you take care of yourself when feeling drained and hitting hitting a creation block?
I call my husband from the streets of New York City, where I'm wandering. I can't do this. This is too much. I'm shutting it down. I just can't. And my husband has to go, okay, honey, what happened tonight? the run of unfolding in New York, I had that moment where I was like, this is so much. That's a really good question. It's like a roller coaster ride. The lows are really low and the highs are really high. The lows used to destroy me. And then I learned, first of all, I'm a very resilient person to begin with. You know, I'm somebody who bounces back from pretty much everything or anything. God forbid something really bad happens. I'm not challenging the universe. But I'm very resilient, and it used to destroy me, where I would think I'm not good enough. I'm, you know, this enough, not smart enough, not talented enough. And then I learned that the process will have lows. The process will have lows. There will be, it's okay. It's just part of it. Have a plan B or try a different. So I've learned, at least I've acquired some artistic wisdom to know that just because I had a bad rehearsal doesn't mean that the whole thing is shit. So pardon my French. And how do I take care of myself? I am very resilient. As I already said, I try to be gentle with myself, and it's like, okay, I need to take a nap. Fine, take a nap. Whatever I need to do, you know, to take care of myself. But I also surround myself with people who care. When I work with people, it's an ensemble that takes care of each other. I've had people walk into the rehearsal room crying, and I would be like, what's going on? Some personal troubles. Okay, no rehearsal today. This is what friends are for. I mean, I try not to make it a habit, but yet we take care of each other. The women I worked with in the last iteration of Unfolding were just some of the most amazing performers I've ever worked with. I also have the backing of my husband. You know, he's always, it's once again, a woman, and no person really can do all of this on their own. I can always, you know, have somebody's like, somebody's watching my back. Somebody will get, you know, will catch me if I absolutely fall. So all of the above, trusting yourself, surrounding yourself with people who care for you, and just knowing that the desire to create art is stronger than the fear of failure, I guess.
That is a beautiful sentiment, I think. And I think we have time for one more question, and we do have one here in the Q&A to sort of segue to thinking about what you're doing here in Iowa. Can you talk a little bit about the production you're working on here at the University of Iowa and with the Department of Theater Arts?
So it was through circumstances we ended up with the idea of creating a devised production, which means once again, we're making it as we go. There's no script. The biggest challenges and yet the biggest rewards, I hope, will be that I did not want to impose my ideas on the students, on the team, and I wanted them to be like, okay, what stories do you want to tell? What is important to you? At the same time, I guess I did encourage them. I felt that with spring coming in 2021, it feels like we are currently living through trauma together, and there's such a need for renewal and a new beginning. So this, we kind of circle around that idea. And then I just asked everybody to bring ideas, and everybody brought ideas, and then I hashed it out and narrowed it down, and then we're going to continue narrowing it, but ultimately it will be created by all of the students, will be the playwrights, all of us, and it will be created by all of us in the rehearsal room. And yeah, the themes are renewal, life and death, the circle of life, cleansing rituals, where's humanity headed? But it's kind of we're tapping into themes that are very, I think, very cathartic for this time and space that we live in.
That is wonderful. I can't wait to hear and see it, hopefully.
And hopefully we'll be performing outside. That's the goal. I did not want to do a Zoom thing. I wanted, you know, theater is for people to come together and to experience the ritual of theater. So we are praying to the gods that the end of April will allow us, but we are planning on performing outside where people can actually come and see and witness and see the river and see the performance and just renew.
That is what we need. We need renewal. Thank you so much, Margarita, for making the time to be with us tonight, for your incredible talk, which was, I have to say too, you are the most prompt speaker that we have ever had. You stuck to that time like nobody's business.
And honestly, I didn't even, I was like, I couldn't see my clock and I was like, I have no idea, but I need to trust my instinct.
You did phenomenally.
I want to say again to everybody out there, please, this shouldn't be the end of the conversation. I am more than happy to talk to people. I'm a captive audience until the end of April, at least in Iowa City. Let's have a conversation. Let's have a glass of wine when we can outside. I hope everybody's out there is actually having one. Yes, and thank you for being here tonight.
And I just want to let everyone know we have two more talks in this series. Both will be on Monday nights. The next one will be March 29th at this same time, 7:30. And then the last one will be April 26th. So we hope you'll join us. And, you know, otherwise, in the meantime, stay safe, be smart out there, and, you know, take care of yourself and the folks around you. Have a wonderful evening,
thank
everyone.
Thank you.
And thank you, Margarita. I'm clapping again.
Thank you.
Really lovely.
Thank you so much. All the best from me.